Hello and welcome to the operating system lecture series. So in this lecture, we'll go through another deadlock handling method, which is called deadlock avoidance. So what happened in the deadlock avoidance? So whenever there is a new request came from the process that it required these much of resources, we'll see the current state. And if the current state allow us to give the resources, and after that my system will be in a safe state, I'll proceed further after giving the resource to that particular process. So in the deadlock avoidance, always there is a guarantee that you will be in a safe state in the deadlock avoidance scheme. Okay, so let's see what is the problem in the deadlock prevention. That we have seen in the deadlock prevention, there are different methods, and in the deadlock prevention, what we have to look, and we have to look only that can we violate any of the four necessary condition of the deadlock. So if we can violate any of the necessary condition of the deadlock, then the prevention could be done, right? But to fulfill the prevention, there are many approaches that we have seen in which there are many restrictions will be applied, many conditions will be applied into the processes as well as in the resources, and because of which the system will become slow because of those restrictions and the conditions. And if the system will be slow, it means that it will reduce the throughput. Throughput means at a particular time frame, how much process is executing into the CPU, or how many process is executing into the system, that is the throughput. So throughput also can get reduced, and eventually it will cause us the resource utilization. But the main work or the main objective of operating system is to utilize the resources in a very efficient way. But because of that, we cannot utilize the resources that we want to utilize. So these are the problem with the prevention. So that another technique has been come up, that is called deadlock avoidance. In the deadlock avoidance, what will happen is, to avoid the deadlock, we require additional information about how resources are to be requested, which resources are process will request and use during its lifetime. That is maximum number of resources of each type that it may need. So in the deadlock avoidance technique, we need some additional information. And what are those information? The information is related to the process. So let's say we have a process P, and this process P is requiring the resource R1, and how many instances of that resources is required. Let's say if it is required 5 resources, let's say there is another resources that is required by the process is 6 instance of that particular resource. Let's say another resource it required, let's say 1 instance of that particular resource. So this is the maximum need or maximum requirement of any process. And at a particular time, how much has been allocated and what is the current need, that all those things we need to calculate. Okay, so what are the things that we have to calculate? So the maximum need we should know, and from the maximum need, how many we have allocated, as well as what is the current need. If we assume that for the resource R1, R2 and R3, we have allocated, let's say, 2 resources of R1 two resources of R2 and one resource of R3. So what is the current need? So current need will be calculated as the max need minus allocated will give you the current need. So max need is 5, allocated is 2. What is the current need? Current need is 3 right now. Max need is 6, current allocated is 2. So the allocated is 2, so current need will be 4. Right, max need is 1, allocated is also 1, so I don't require any resource from R3 or any instance of R3 resource. Yeah, so these information should be there for this type of algorithms. With this additional knowledge, the operating system can decide for each resource whether process should wait or not. So if we'll calculate all those requirement of the process, and after that we'll decide that that process need to wait or the process will proceed with the resources. Okay, so we need some data structure like this. So this is the data structure that we'll use in the Banker's algorithm. Banker's algorithm is a very famous deadlock avoidance algorithm that will apply for deadlock avoidance. So let's see what are the different data structure will be used here. So here it is showing you the resource, that is resource E, F, and G. This is some resource E, some resource F, and some resource G. So assume that, let's say E is your CPU, F is your, let's say, RAM, and G is your, let's say, storage. The storage means your hard drive. So I need some resources, right, for executing. So let's say for E, there is some maximum required of P1. So P0, the process P0, or the process P1, or the process P2, or the process P. So I'll put those values, which indicates that these much of instance of these resources are required by the process, right? Now, after putting up the maximum need, how many has been currently allocated to that particular process? So that I'll put here. And after doing the maximum need and currently allocated, I can find out the what is the need, right? So currently allocated, let's say for P0, let's say the two instance is the maximum requirement. Here for F, 3 instance is the maximum requirement. Here for G, 4 instance is the maximum requirement. Let's say the allocation is 111. So what is the current need right now? Because we have allocated 111 instance of these resources, from the maximum need I can calculate like it required 1, 2, and 3 instance of E, F, and G. That is a current need. Now, what this max system max is saying you? System max is saying you that in the system, how many instances of resource E is available? How many instances of resource F is available? How many instances of resource G is available? Let's assume that the maximum instance is, let's say, 10 instances are there in the system, right? And I'll put up all those things, so I'll from the allocation, I can calculate that how much are available. Okay. So let's say I'll put some random values here. So let's say for P1, I required, let's say, 4 instance here, 5 instance here, and let's say 4 instance here. For this, this is the maximum need, right? So this is, let's say, 5 instance, and I required 5 for that. Let's say for this, it is 6, and it is, let's say, 4, it is, let's say, these are the maximum need. How many allocate? Let's say the allocation is like this. It is allocated 210. It is allocated, let's say, 132. This is allocated, let's say, 313. Okay. Now, if I have done this, how many are available? So I have to calculate, like, allocated is 1, 2. That is 1 plus 2, it is 3. 3 plus 3, it is 6. So 6 has been allocated. Now what is available? because the maximum is 10, 6 is already allocated, so 4 is available. Getting it? Now this is allocated, this is 1, 1, this is 2, 2 plus 3, it is 5, 5 plus 1, it is 6. And what is the maximum? 10. So from 10, 6 has been allocated, 4 is left. So 1 plus 2, it is 3, 3 plus 1, it is 4, 4 plus 3, it is 7. 10 is the maximum. So how much is left over is 3. So 3, 4 and 4 is available here, right? Now, what is the current need? So I told you for the current need, I have to take the maximum need minus allocated. The maximum need is 4, 5, 4. The allocated is 2, 1, 0. So what is the need here? The need here will be 2, 4 and 4. This is my current need. Now for P2, what is the current need? It is 3, 5, 5 is maximum one. Allocated is 1, 3 and 2. So the need will be 2, 2 and 3. For P3, the maximum need is 3, sorry, 6. Allocated is 3, 3 is left. Maximum need is of instance F is 4. Allocated is 1, 3 is left. 3 is currently needed, right? And for G, 3 has been maximum, 3 has been allocated, so 0 is left. I don't require any instance of G in the current position, right? Now, after doing or after filling all those things, I'll go for the sequence of process that I can fulfill the request. Now, if you'll see here, what is available? Available is 3, 4, 3, right? This is the current state, which is, let's say at time T0 or at time T, this is the current state, okay? And I require to fulfill the request. Let's say P0, P0 is required 1, 2, 3. Can I fulfill the request? 3, 4, 4 is available? Yes, I can fulfill the request because if I'll give 3, from 3, if I'll give 1, it will be fulfilled. From 4, if I'll give 2, that will be fulfilled. Or from 4, if I'll give 3, that will be fulfilled, right? So can I go for P0? Yes, I can go for P0. Can I go with P1 first? 2, it required 2. It required 4, it required 4. Yes. So I have the available and the current need is also can be fulfilled from here. So I can go for P1 also. Can I go to P2 with the current available? 2, 2, 3. It is having 3, 4, 3. Can I go for that? Yes, I can go. Next is 3, 3, 0. Can I fulfill the request with 3, 3, 0? Yes, I can fulfill the request with 3, 3, 0. So I can go for anyone. Means I can initiate with P0 or I can initiate with P1 or I can initiate with P2 or I can initiate with P3. Means any of the process can be allocated the resource, right? Now, let's go for another scenario here. So the scenario is like that. Now here, the maximum availability of this particular resource is, previously it was 10. Now I am assuming that in the system it is 7. Now for this, the maximum availability here, it is, let's say, 7. For this, the maximum availability here is, let's assume that it is 8. Right? Now, this is the maximum resource which is available. Now, after the allocation, what is available? So, if you'll calculate this, this is 3, 3, 3, 6, 7. It is 0 instance which is left. Okay, so I can increase it because I cannot fulfill anything here. So, what I'll do is, we'll go for other... example, let's say I have 9 available. So let's calculate this. So this will be 7, 7, 9. It will be 2 left. It is 5 and 6, 1 left. Let's assume that it is 3, 3, 6, 2 left. Now, with this current availability, can I fulfill anything? So, can I fulfill the requirement of P0? Here it is 1. 1 can be fulfilled here. It is required 2. 2 cannot be fulfilled. It is required 3. 3 cannot be fulfilled. Means P0, we cannot, with the help of available resources, P0 could not be fulfilled. Now, go for P1. Can I fulfill the request of P1? It is required 2. But it required 4 instances, but we have 1 and 2. I cannot fulfill. What about the P2? For the first one, I can fulfill, but the second and third one, I cannot fulfill. Now, come to the last process, 3, 3, 3, 3, 0, 0. It is required, it is having 2, 1, 2. I cannot fulfill. So you can see here, in this particular case, no process can execute further. No process can execute further if this is the scenario. Okay. Now, let's slightly change the scenario where we have partially fulfilling the request. Okay. So, let's say this one is 9 instances. Let's assume this one is also 9 instances. And let's assume this one is also 9 instances. Okay. Now, let's go for the availability. Here it will be 3, 3, 7, 2 is left. Here it will be 5 and 1, 6, 3 is left. Here it is 5 and 6, 3 is left. Okay. Now, with this particular current scenario or current availability, which particular process we can fulfill. Now, if we'll go for P0, can we fulfill the requirement of P0? Required 1, yes, it can be fulfilled. Required 2, yes, can be fulfilled because 3 is available. Required 3, 3 is available, right? So I can go for P1. Can I fulfill P0? Can I fulfill P1? It's required 2, 2 will be fulfilled, but 4 and 4 is here, but the availability is 3 and 3 instances, which cannot be fulfilled. Now, can I go for P2? Yes, I can go for P2 because 2, 2, 3 is required. I have 2 and 3 is here and 3 is available here. So, I can go for that. Can I execute P3? It required 3 instances. I have only 2 instances. So, I can go for either P0 or I can go for P2. So, let's assume that I am going for P0. So once I am going for P0, I am allocating. So currently need is, I am fulfilling. So currently need is 1, 2, 3. And I have allocated 1, 2, 3. So what is allocated? Allocated will be 1 was there previously, it will become 2. 1 was there previously, it will become 3. 1 was there previously, it will become 4. So 2, 3 and 4 will be allocated. Now, this current need is right now 0 because I have allocated all those things. And how much I have given? I have given 1 instance here, so 1 is left. I have given 2 instance here, so 1 is left. And I have given 3 instance here, so 0 is left. So, this is the availability. 1, 1, 0 is the availability. Getting it? Now, we know that once we give the resources to the process will execute its execution and then it will release its resources and terminate, right? So let's assume that P0, we have given the resource to P0, whatever the maximum requirement is, 2, 3, 4, I have given already. So P0 will execute and release all its resources. So what is the resources it has right now? 2, 3, 4. When it will release 2, 3, 4, what is the availability? So availability, if you can see here, when we add 2 here, when we add 3 here, or when we add 4 here, the availability will be, so the current availability, I'm just calculating here is 3, 4 and 4. This is my current availability. So I'm putting the current availability here. What is it? 344. Why? 110 was left. The allocated is 234, which will be released by P0. So I'll add 234 here and I'll get the, okay. So I'll get the available here. So I am putting this available here, which is 343. 344. Sorry, 344. After executing P0. Now this is the availability, right? If this is the availability, can I fulfill the next? Can I go for P1? 244, can I fulfill this? Yes, I can fulfill this. So I can go for P1. So as you know that instead of doing 0 here and allocating here like 4, 5, and 4, which is the maximum requirement, what I'll do is I'll just take the, what is allocated, okay, and add it to it. So instead of doing the manipulation in all three data structure, I'll just take 210 was there. So I'll just take 210 from the allocated and I'll add it here. And the available will be 4, 5 and 5 after P1 will execute. So with the 5 and 4, can I fulfill the request of P2? Yes, I can do. Right. So what is allocated here? 132. After adding 132, what I'll get here? 1, it will become 6. 3, it will become 8. 2, it will become 6. This is the availability. Now I can fulfill the request of P3 with the available one. Yes, I can do that. What is the allocated is 313. So I'll add 313 here. What is the value I'll get is 9, 9, and 9. This is the maximum I'll get after executing all the process, which is P1, P2, and P3. I can get my available resources, which is the maximum available resource. This is how the banker's algorithm won. And the sequence that we are having for the processes is called safe sequence. The sequence, which is let's say P0, then P1, then P2, then P3, I have applied here. That sequence is called safe sequence. Okay. Let's try to understand the banker's algorithm with the another example. Before that, let's talk about this algorithm. In this particular deadlock avoidance algorithm, which is a banker algorithm, this is a dynamic examine the resource allocation. So in this example, we have seen that dynamically we calculate the availability of the resources, and based on the current need, we fulfill the request of the process, right? So it is the dynamic way of examination. The resource allocation state is defined by the number of available and allocated resources and the maximum demand of the process before allowing that particular request first. So we have to find out what is the maximum demand of that particular process and how much are the available resources. And based on that, we try to fulfill the request of the process. Otherwise, it has to wait, right? It's as simple as that. Let's assume that this is a scenario at a particular time, let's say time T0. This is the scenario of the system. What is the scenario? That a P0 is the maximum need is this, allocated at that particular time is this, and the current need is this, right? So as I told you, how we can calculate the current need, maximum need minus allocated, we can get the current. Maximum resources instances, that is for 8, 4 and 6 for E, F and G resource. And what is available? Available will be calculated how many allocated minus the maximum system resource is. So we have calculated 330, right? So how it will be calculated? Let's say, so for the G resource, the instances that has been given is 6. 6 is the maximum one. So we have 0 resources for 0 instances of G resource. 1 we have allocated, 4 is the maximum one, so 3 is available. 5 we have allocated, 8 is the maximum, so 3 is available, right? So with the available, can we fulfill the current need of the system? Okay, and can we go for executing the process? So we doesn't have to execute all the process at a time. We have to find out the sequence of the process execution. So that is the requirement of the banker's algorithm, that with the current need, can I fulfill one process? I'll go for that. So let's say the process P0 required 3, 3, and 0 resources. Do we have available 3, 3, and 0? Yes, 3, 3, and 0 resources are available. So can I go for that? Yes, I can go for that. And I'll go for P0 for execution. Now, once I'll go for P0 for execution, this is the available. Available is 330. Available is 330. I have given the need, whatever it is. So with the help of 330, I have given it. And allocated is 101. So once it will execute, it will release the allocated resources, that is 101. So what is my current one? Current available. A current available will be, that will be 4, 3, and 1. So it will be 4, 3, and 1. So 4, 3, 1 is my current available. Can I fulfill the request of P1 with that? If you can see, it required 4. It required 1. 1 will be given. 0 will be given. 2 cannot be given because it is having only one resource available. Only one instance available of the resource G, right? So it cannot be fulfilled. So for that, what we'll do? We'll not do anything. We'll go for other process. And we'll check for other process can be fulfilled. Now, other process is P2. P2 required 030. Can we have 030? Yes. We have 4 resources here, 3 resources here, and 1 resource here. I can give it. So what is the next process? This is P2 is the next process. After executing the P2, it will release that particular resource. So what is the resource I have currently is 431, right? 431. After releasing this particular resource, that is 103, I'll add up and I'll get these many resources which is available in the current state after executing P2. So what I'll do is, I'll just replace this to my current available resources. So current available resources will be 5, this is 3, and this is 4. Now with the help of 534, can I execute P2? Can I execute P2? So, P3. It required 3, 4, 3. I have 5. It is okay. But I don't have 4. We have 3 only. I cannot go for P3. So where I'll go? Which is left? Can I fulfill the requirement of P1? It is 101. 102. 102. I can give it. 1. I can give it. 0. It is 3. I can give it. 2. It is 4. I can give it. Right? So I'll go for P1. Once I'll go for P1, the resources that is allocated will be released, right? So what is my available resources right now? My available resources are 534. I'm executing P1 by fulfilling the requirement. Because the current requirement 102, I can fulfill it. So P1 will execute and it will release the resource, that is 1, 1, and 2 instances. I can calculate it. 6 instances will be left, 4 instances will be left, and here 6 instances will be left. So this is my available. Available is 6, 4, and 6. So I am updating my available data structure, which is 6. 4, 6. With the help of 646, can I fulfill the request of P3? It required 341. 341. Yes, I can fulfill. So the next is P3. Now P3 will execute its execution and it will release the resources which is allocated to it. So because my current available is 646. When I'll take the P2, it will be 200. So how much is available right now? 6 instances here, 4 instances here, and 8 instances here. So if you can see, this is the maximum resources that is there with the system, 846. I can get 846 after executing all the processes. This is the banker's algorithm. If I cannot fulfill the request of any process, I'll not allow that process to execute. It's simple as that, right? So when I am fulfilling the its current need, then only I'll go for execution for that particular process. This is called banker's algorithm. So the sequence that I am getting here is called safe sequence. Right, and safe sequence. So we know that in the state, we have three state: safe state, unsafe state, and deadlock state. So banker's algorithm, as well as you can say deadlock avoidance algorithm, will make sure that your system will always be in a safe state. Once your system will be in an unsafe state, it doesn't mean that there is a deadlock, right? So there is, in the unsafe state also, your system can run, but there is a chance, there is a slight chance to be deadlocked. That is the meaning of this particular diagram. So in the banker's algorithm, we check if there exists some sequence in which we can satisfy the demand of each process without going into deadlock. If yes, the sequence is called safe sequence and a request can be allowed. Otherwise, there is a possibility of going into the deadlock. So the sequence will be there, then it is called safe sequence. And if safe sequence is there, then definitely I can say that my system will not go into the deadlock. If there is a unsafe state, so there is a chance to my system to go into the deadlock. So banker's algorithm will make sure that my system will never go into the unsafe state. Okay. So this is the banker's algorithm or deadlock avoidance algorithm.